Hello and welcome. We are live on University Radio Nottingham. On today's show we have Freya.
Hiya.
Sarah.
Hello.
Cameron.
Hello.
And George.
Sound. Hello.
We say we've got quite a big panel today. So today we're discussing Partygate. I mean, lots has happened since we were last here. And we are discussing the BBC, the future of the BBC, and we're going to be talking about rewilding the countryside. So first of all, Partygate. So since we last spoke, there have been a numerous number of parties that have come out since the original Christmas one. We've had some in May 2020 that Boris Johnson has admitted that he was at after originally denying that he broke any COVID rules. And we have had parties that occurred in Downing Street on the eve of the Duke of Edinburgh's funeral, which of course the Queen sat alone after the death of her husband of over 70 years, which reflected something that many people have gone through in the entire country. And since then, many Conservatives have called for Boris to go. Perhaps most famously, David Davis in the House of, in Prime Minister's Questions called for Boris to leave. Douglas Ross, the leader of the Scottish Conservatives, have also called for Boris Johnson to resign. Christian Wakeford, a Conservative MP for Bury South, well, I should say former Conservative MP for Bury South, he's now a member of the Labour Party. So it's been quite a bad week for the government, and yet Boris Johnson is still there. And so we'll be talking about Partygate. We'll talk about what we think is going to happen to Boris. What about our new Labour MP for Bury South, Christian Wakeford? So, hopefully, let's. What do you think? What do you think, everyone, to this?
Who's going first, Felix?
Up to you. You.
I've got something to say on Christian Wakeford.
Go on. What do you think on Christian?
Well, obviously, initially, when I first saw it, I thought it was a good kind of two fingers to Boris Johnson that a conservative MP had defected to the Labour Party. But what I've read since on this guy is he doesn't seem, and I'm pretty tolerant of all people across all sides of the political spectrum, but and I'm specifically talking about the left here, but like this guy doesn't seem left wing at all, because in any capacity, because he's voted against, I've got ad blocker on here, so I can't see the actual thing.
Yeah.
But he's voted against like universal credit and children's school meals, and I don't think that's someone that really is should sort of. I don't like to like be exclusionary of people, but what is this man? Is it just sort of a political move? Well, like is it just to save his own career?
Because the majority is just over 300 votes.
Yeah.
He has claimed that he voted against free school meals despite wanting free school meals because of the whips threatening to withhold funding to a new secondary school in one of his towns. That's what he's claimed.
That does sound in itself full of self-interest, though.
I mean, I'm not going to deny it. Sarah, what do you think?
I think it's, as a Labour Party member, I feel like obviously we should be trying to get Tory voters, let alone Tory MPs, into our party. It's the only way we're going to win elections in the near future. However, I think it's absurd that we've got someone that's voted against universal credit and in our party when Jeremy Corbyn is still barred. I do not understand that at all, and it infuriates me. But also, a point about Boris Johnson. I think, as much as I really dislike the man, I think he's absolutely amazing that he's managed to stay this long. I can't think of any other politician that would manage to stay this long, because he's got no morals. As much as I dislike Margaret Thatcher, and I really, really did, at least she had some morals. Whereas I think Boris Johnson he's just totally void of any morals at all.
Freya, what do you reckon to all of this?
I mean, I think the defection's certainly going to do wonders for Keir Starmer's attempt to sort of claim Middle England, as he tries to sort of rebrand the Labour Party as a party that the middle class can sort of drift towards. But I certainly do understand the feeling that there should be a by-election, considering, you know, he was voted in as a Tory and now isn't a Tory. So people that want a Tory in the seat will want a by-election. Labour members that don't want an ex-Tory in the seat will also want a by-election. So I can understand that. To Boris Johnson, I agree with what Sarah said. Like, it is like impressive how many scandals this guy has been able to last. We've had Dominic Cummings, Matt Hancock, Priti Patel breaking the ministerial code, the school meal scandal, expenses, and now this. It seems to be like no end to the amount of scandals this guy can take. I mean, I think we're maybe coming to the end of how much he can take. I don't know what you guys think about that.
Yeah, this is the Teflon finally running out from Boris. Cameron, what do you reckon to all of this?
I think it's a sort of quite a good example of bad karma on Boris's part. So on the 23rd of March in 2020, he did something he knew was wrong and thought he could get away with. He put in place a lockdown, which he knew was illegal. And he did that because it was popular at the time, and he caved into popular pressure. And now, because he couldn't even follow his own rules, he's facing the consequences of that. So it just goes to show, if you're unprincipled, it will come back around to you eventually. As for him resigning, well, he probably should. I mean, it would be the sort of save a remnant of dignity for him, but I would be concerned about who would become his successor. Mm. Better to have someone incompetent in charge than someone who's competently bad. As for the defection, it's just clearly he's just trying to protect himself, and he'll probably be voted out next time around anyway, so...
Well, do you think the Labour constituency party and Barry South are even going to like Christian Wakeford being there? Bearing in mind, he's called them words I cannot say on the radio. Do you think they're going to actually let him be their representative?
Yeah, they might be refused as the successor.
If I was in that CLP, I would definitely not let him be our representative. It's absolutely crazy. I understand it would be very upsetting to be a Conservative Party member at the moment. It's really, really infuriating to be a Labour Party member too, because we're just so incompetent. This is when we should be capitalising. We should, after this defection, we should now be focusing on economic policies with the inflation that's going to come. We'll be able to capitalise on that. But at the moment, it's just nothing is happening. And Keir Starmer welcomed this Tory MP with open arms, and yet he rejects Jeremy Corbyn still.
Well, that's the interesting thing, isn't it, about what is the Labour Party, what is the Labour Party? In a way, Christian Wakeford sitting there behind Keir Starmer with his union flag mask will probably be beneficial for Keir Starmer to make
patriotic
people
here.
Believe. Well, yes, he says it's his patriotic duty to support these measures.
You can't deny that was a power move, though, him walking across the aisle to sit with the Labour Party. You can't deny that was impressive entertainment to see in Parliament.
Oh, what, Mr. Wakeford. Yeah, I was going to call him something else then. Yeah. But,
Do you think Boris Johnson is going to survive this, or is this the final scandal that will bring him down?
I honestly think he will be able to worm his way out of it again. What I was going to say something else. I was going to say the thing with the Labour Party. Okay, it's good that the Labour Party 11 points ahead of the Conservatives, but I think that's only because the government is so bad and everyone's so annoyed with the government, and it's not that Keir Starmer offers any substantial vision to the Labour Party. What do the Labour Party want to do at the next election? I don't really see much vision.
Well, this is a good point, because
which is depressing.
Labour is 10 points on average now ahead of the Conservatives, if not a little bit more. But if you look into the details, because these polls often exclude don't knows, only 10% of these Conservative voters that have rejected the party have gone to Labour. All the other 90% have either gone to the Liberal Democrats, Reform UK, or the biggest chunk of them are not going to vote. And if you're saying you're not going to vote, what are the chances are you are probably going to end up going back to the Conservative Party? Ultimately, this is just a sort of a disgust. Because, of course, MPs across the Conservative Party have had a lot of very angry, and rightly so, constituents writing to them. Because the Conservative Party, it seems, at the top, or at least the civil service with the encouragement of the government, we don't really know. Sue Gray's report might enlighten us. That's at least what the government keeps saying, although I'm not quite sure what Sue Gray is going to say that will be beneficial to them, because let's say the best Sue Gray's report is going to say technically they were within the rules, because maybe it was Crown property, but technically being in the rules is not going to really work with people. But Boris Johnson has an ability that no other politician has, which, or at least at the moment, where he can just be forgiven by people. And I don't think anyone else could survive this.
I think it's a case of a bit like with Trump. People are so used to him behaving in a certain way, they're not surprised. But we're saying that it's great that now the Labour Party are up in the polls. But the destruction of the country wrought in the last couple of years by the lockdown, Boris didn't even support that. He's incompetent, as is his government, but the sort of well-aimed malice of the Labour Party would the damage would be massive to working people. they're forcing people not to go to work. That's actually against the Magna Carta, which says you're not allowed to bring a free man to ruin. You're not allowed to take away their livelihood. So it's in violation of the very foundation of our country. Labour Party hate England. They, for example, they supported our defeat in the Falklands War. So if you think they're going to be better off with them in charge, because the Conservatives have done damage through lockdown and recently, they don't really support it fully. Some of them do, but if we were to sort of switch over to Labour just because we don't like the Conservatives, then we might find out the real damage that can be done by a bad government.
I think. This
and
is
what is that damage?
Damage. The damage done to people's lives, for example, mental health, not being allowed to go out and see people. They supported further lockdown measures, taking away freedom. They want to bring in sort of
they weren't the government. I have to say one thing. I do admit, like, I've been anti this lockdown thing the whole time, and I'm not agreeing with this guy on that Labour hate England at all. But I do think the Labour Party would be more obsessed with the collective in terms of about it being everyone being safer and all this. And I'm just, let me live my life, man. I don't agree with him, but like, yeah. I do think the lockdown restrictions potentially could have been stricter and potentially more draconian.
Yeah, like in China.
But I'm not. But
China,
I'm not,
a socialist
but
anyway, state.
But,
right.
Why don't you anything really like China?
Sarah, the Labour member. Let's let Sarah say what she's going to
do. I think claiming that the Labour Party hates England is absolutely hilarious at the moment, especially the things that, like, with Keir Starmer, virtually everything he does, he's got a Union flag in the background, and it's all very patriotic and wonderful. And I don't think that the Labour Party opposed the Falklands War because they hated England. I think it's because they don't like imperialism, you know.
They don't support British citizens on the islands' freedom from a dictatorship.
I think having some islands on the other side of the globe It's a bad legacy.
Populated by Englishmen.
It's an absolutely appalling legacy of colonialism, which we still have. I oppose our continued presence in Gibraltar. It shouldn't be that. But anyway, the Labour Party does not hate England. I am an international socialist, but at the moment, Keir Starmer is not. He really supports England, and although it's upsetting for me, it's the truth.
I mean, we're not here to talk about the Falklands War or whether Labour hate England or whatever it is. It's a slight divergence, as interesting as it might be. So getting back to Sue Gray's report, I think there's going to be some problems with Sue Gray's report just inherent in it, because, you know, Sue Gray isn't an independent, it's not an independent review. She's employed by the Tories. So she's going to be limited in terms of her access to information. And I was watching Emily Thornberry, I think it was, on Question Time.
Yeah.
And she was basically talking about how civil service members were being asked to sort of clean up their phones and sort of not hide evidence, but, you know, get rid of things that might be potentially damning. So Sue Gray's report, however, whatever you might think of her reputation, I've seen nothing to suggest that she doesn't have a good reputation. She's going to be limited by the scope of that report anyway. So I'm not sure what they're expecting it to say.
Do you think that once Sue Gray's report does come out, that might be the moment that the 54 MPs are reached in terms of the letters being sent to the 1922 backbench committee, and that a vote of no confidence might be called in Boris Johnson? Or do you think, actually, no, the Conservative MPs are going to keep Boris in place?
Well, I don't know. The whips are being very threatening at the moment, aren't they, with this blackmail thing? You cannot... say anything bad about the government, otherwise we're going to like leak bad stories about you and stuff like that. So that could have a factor in the way this vote of no confidence would work out for Boris Johnson.
I think that Conservative MPs will keep Boris Johnson in because he is ultimately an election winner, and I know that it is a national election is quite far away. I think ultimately that's his most important asset, but I do think that this has really damaged public confidence in Boris Johnson and the Conservative Party. I think his lack of principles after most people have followed the rules very strictly. His disregard of these rules is just quite shocking. And I think that when inflation hits, which I don't think is going to be very long, I think that's when he'll have to resign, because I think that will tip over the edge for most people.
Yeah. But if he does resign, then what you're left with is a danger that, you know, just saying, oh, Boris Johnson should resign and that's the problem solved. Actually, there were many people at these parties, top civil service members, top Tory members, like, the problem doesn't start and finish with Boris Johnson's resignation, and there's a danger that he'll become a scapegoat for the mistakes of the party in general, and then the front runners at the moment are Sunak and Truss, I guess.
And yeah, and I think Sunak would be. I think Sunak would be worse than Boris Johnson.
I don't think Sunak's experienced enough.
Yeah, yeah, but I just think he'd be more of a sort of hardline economic Tory.
I think Liz Truss even more than Sunak, I think Liz Truss is looking to try and be Margaret Thatcher with being on a tank.
Oh, Vladimir Putin's really going to listen to Liz Truss about all this backing off at the border stuff. Oh yeah, Liz Truss telling old Vladimir
Remember
Putin.
That we import over 50% of our cheese, and that is a disgrace.
I think overall the whole story about Boris breaking his own rules is a distraction from the fact the rules just shouldn't have been there in the first place. So yes, it's bad that he broke the rules, but it's bad that he broke the rules because he made the rules. I break the rules all the time. It doesn't matter because I don't think anyone.
I agree with you, but these restrictions were. I've hated the whole. I'm really anti it, in that sense. But the governments across the world were implementing this, and at the time it was we were in such a like unknown situation. I think it was the best thing to do at the time, but ever since what's come out of it, I think it was a waste of time. But at the time.
Yeah, that
I think
first
we're in the right place. Yeah. Because
I think we pitched it right at that first lockdown. But then this has come out and has sort of, you know, been a real slap in the face to everyone that did put their trust in the government and did put their trust in Boris Johnson specifically. And like had a felt that we were all in it for the sake for good reasons, safe, and now that's just really undermined that.
I think the lockdowns were important because as a socialist, I think in terms of the collective, so it is important to keep everyone collectively try and keep us as safe as possible, but then when the rule makers are not part of said collective, it does cause friction.
But where's the Met Office investigation? There's none.
This is very interesting, isn't it?
Yeah, because Cressida Dick, there was a whole Sever Everard thing and Boris Johnson didn't sack her, so there's obviously this bit of a thing now that Boris Johnson, that Cressida Dick's not investigating Boris Johnson in this party as like a favour.
Yeah, but
back.
If you think back to like
bare
corrupt
people, man.
We
honest
were having
to God.
Parties in Lenton, for example, were being dispersed by the police and people were getting fined for that. And maybe people thought the fines were a bit harsh, but ultimately people supported the police's right to break up a party that at that time was illegal. And now flash cut to now, where essentially the same thing has been happening in Downing Street and there's no Met Office investigation into it. I think it's ridiculous.
The Met Police have referred themselves off to the Independent Police Review, so I don't know whether or not that report has come back yet, but they have referred themselves off, so because of their decision not to investigate.
Why isn't more focus being that? Is actually so like despicable and undemocratic and outrageous.
Well, that's what I'm saying.
No, I agree. I'm just saying,
Hopefully that will come back from the review that they do need to investigate, but...
Cressida Dick should resign. You heard it first here on URN.
Boris Johnson doesn't seem to sack anybody, does he? He doesn't... When the emails came out from his... we found out about his emails from his private secretary, Martin Reynolds, about the Bring Your Own Booze party at Downing Street, Boris Johnson said he had his full confidence behind him, and
it's
he
probably
refused
they
to sign
on him, Felix. Yeah. And if he fires them, they might tell a little story,
like Mr. Cummins.
Yeah, exactly.
Although seems to love him now, and I'm like, I don't. Just because like people on the left seem to like him because he's some kind of like anti-hero, and I'm like, nah, he's just. He's Dominic Cummins.
Disgruntled ex-employee.
Yeah, he's a disgruntled ex-employee. He wants to get his back on board. Like, I'm not feeding into his whole narrative.
But I do remember at the time the Dominic Cummings scandal came out, thinking, why isn't Boris Johnson throwing him under the bus? It's really this is really strange. Why isn't he firing him?
Yeah.
Now,
so obviously now
it
makes
sense.
Right. Well, I think that we are going to move on now to the next topic. But first, let's enjoy a song that is often played at parties. Perhaps even at Downing Street, this was played whilst we were all inside. Mr. Brightside. Hello and welcome back. Apologies if we had technical difficulties at the beginning of the show. It's unknown whether or not we did, because the radio station's coming back on air after the Christmas break, and sometimes people come outside and say there's a problem, but no one did because no one's there. So I don't know if there was a problem, so apologies if there were. And if there wasn't a problem, then I don't know why I'm saying this. There we go. Okay, the second topic is on the BBC. So Operation Red Meat or Save Big Dog or something like this is going on in the government to try and distract people from the party gate. And one of these is the Culture Secretary, Nadine Dorris, has announced that the TV licence is going to be frozen for the next 2 years, and there will be a debate about what will happen when the royal charter of the BBC runs out in 2027. The BBC, of course, is celebrating its 100th anniversary this year. But there are discussions about the future of the BBC. Is it going to become a subscription-based service, or is it going to become more like ITV with adverts? Imagine having adverts in the middle of Strictly Come Dancing. Anyway, is this, what is going to happen to the BBC? Are the government just doing this as a distraction? Do they just hate the BBC because of the BBC's coverage of what they're doing? What is going on? What do you think should happen to the BBC? Is it right that we have a TV tax? Let's start with George. George, what do you think on this?
I'm a big supporter of the TV licence, but if people don't want to pay it, that's entirely up to them. Okay, it's like £140 a year or whatever, but then obviously I think this is a complete distraction from Nadine Dorries. Why is she going on about, oh, she cares about bailiffs going to people's houses and all this about the TV licence when we've got this cost of living crisis, and she's not mentioning about bailiffs coming around to people's houses for that. Do you know what I mean? It's funny that. And I think the BBC is a great institution, and I'd like to work for it one day. And I think Amanda Luciano is the writer of Alan Partridge in Luciano. He said that this will mean more Americanized drama for on British screens. I don't want that, to be honest. I want good British drama, because how can I really relate to, like some American dramas, but how can I really relate to, obviously there's going to be that gap there, there's going to be billions cut. Yeah, I don't want to see more American drama, I want to see some good British drama. It seems like the quality, since the cuts have come in since 2010, the quality and the standard of the BBC has declined, and that's a shame, because they're capable of making such great programmes. And then that's one thing. And then another thing, the Tories have always been so paranoid about the BBC, but I don't actually know why. I think more often than not they're very fair and they're very balanced, and I really don't see what the Tory obsession is with getting rid. I think Nadine Dorries, it's like a populist move as well. Yeah, anyway, I said a lot there, but I ranted on.
Hatred for the BBC. Yeah. I think some of the examples the Conservatives believe, whether you think that's true or not, is that they believe the BBC was quite anti-Brexit with the despite Brexit, blah, blah, blah. I think that is one of the positions the Conservatives take, whether that's true or not. Is up for you and the audience at home to look into. What other thoughts do you have? Sarah, Freya, Cameron?
I think the BBC is a flawed institution, but I think most institutions are. But so I think the BBC is biased, but then I also my more right-wing friends do also think the BBC is biased. Therefore, they must be doing something. Mm. Okay, if we both don't like them, then they must be reaching some sort of middle ground. And I think it's important. So Jeremy Corbyn in 2018 proposed some changes to the BBC, like making pay more transparent, things like that. That those are changes that need to happen, and important changes. I think that the BBC should be kept, but I think maybe a kind of council tax kind of scheme as well would be better than the TV license, because I think it's absurd that people from a higher income background pay the same as everyone else. It's just, that's just completely ridiculous. So I would change that. I think
the BBC is a national disgrace, to be honest, especially the way it's behaved in the last 10 years. This panel is actually rather BBC like three people from the left and then one person from the right, myself. That's likely more balanced than most BBC shows you'd find. BBC Question Time, any comedy around the Brexit, time of Brexit, every single joke, or at least 90% of the jokes, comedians on there were pro-remaining, shackled to the...
I don't actually disagree.
Comedy in general is a more left-wing thing.
Of course, but the BBC has a responsibility to find people from both sides, because it's meant to be balanced. Comedy as a whole might
not be... Jeff Norcott was on there, and he was quite good. But
one person out of, say, 100. But yes, I used to enjoy watching the BBC, fantastic, history documentaries with, say, David Starkey, great shows like shows like Top Gear. Those are fantastic. But now the BBC is now a servant of the COVID fear-mongering. If you turn on the news, I don't watch telly at all, but if I ever accidentally turn it on whilst I'm going on to Amazon or Netflix, but, and it goes to the main channels, you'll see constant death. Coronavirus is going to kill us. We must have a lockdown now. That's all you'll see in the BBC. Same with climate change. During the big climate summit that's going on, once again, I look through the channels. Everything on the evening was BBC. You know, they'll have David Attenborough on there, who's well respected by people, spouting a massively exaggerated version of climate change designed to scare people into supporting measures that would take away their freedom. And he gets paid millions in order to do it, whilst having spent his life flying around the world photographing wild animals, and now telling poorer people that they won't be able to fly because fuel prices will go up because of the tax that he thinks should be put on fuel. The BBC is a disgrace. It employs people who are doing vast damage to the country, and it has led to people becoming afraid of things they should not be scared of. The only thing we have to fear is fear itself, as FDR said. And the BBC is now a merchant of fear. It is shameful, and the public should not be paying for it, and the state should not own it.
You make it sound totalitarian, my friend. what I was going to say, yeah, no, I agree. What's your name? Sorry, Sarah.
Sarah.
I agree with Sarah. Actually, what she said, I think David Dimbleby said a similar thing about that. You know, maybe there it should be like streamlined in terms of who should pay what for the BBC licence fee. I think that would be, I don't know how it would quite work, but I think that would be a fairer way of doing it. Because I suppose it is essentially a poll tax. I mean, I support the fee, but I suppose if you don't want to pay it, you shouldn't be made to. That's as well, I think.
What do you think?
I think Cameron's criticisms of the BBC, you know, it being fear-mongering during COVID, I have some sympathy with that view. But potentially disagree when it comes to climate change slightly, but I would make those criticisms of mainstream press in general, and indeed of social media news outlets as well. I don't think that's a problem that's unique to the BBC.
Only one media institution is funded by taxpayers and owned by the government entirely, and that's the BBC.
Yeah, but the thing that annoys me about this debate is that it's being couched in, oh, we're saving the common man money. And you know what's crippling the common people isn't the BBC license.
43p a day, yeah.
Yeah, it's not the BBC fee license that's making their lives harder. It's rising energy prices, rising cost of living, rising housing prices. These are things that actually affect common people.
Which Nadine Dorries isn't addressing.
Yeah, and it's all just distraction techniques. There's no actual concrete plan for what they're going to do with the BBC, how they're going to fund it in the future. Like, it's just, smoke and mirrors to take away from the problems that we're actually seeing with what we were talking about earlier with the whole Partygate scandal.
I would also like to go back to the BBC being pro-left-wing, because I'd like to reference the treatment of Jeremy Corbyn by the BBC. It was outrageous, frankly. I particularly remember a kind of background image of Jeremy Corbyn wearing, like, a cap that Lenin used to wear and things like that was kind of photoshopped on. And it was all very, very dramatic. So I think the BBC is a fan of centrism. But also, to be fair, it has limited. It hasn't shown much of Keir Starmer, to be fair, and I think that's one of the reasons why.
Not much to show.
Labour. I think that's one of the main reasons why Labour is struggling in the polls. Because if you actually look at what he's doing, he is criticising the government. Obviously, he's not shouting about it enough. But the BBC aren't really picking up on it. So I don't think that you can say the BBC are just this left-wing institution, because they're not.
In the same way that every other media outlet is, they're making money off your outrage. So they go to the things that are going to provoke outrage. Right now, that's Boris Johnson, not Keir Starmer being sort of semi-reasonable in the corner. Like that's what the BBC want. That's what media outlets in general want. I think that's something that could be addressed. I'm not even sure how you would go about changing that. But I certainly don't think that your criticisms of the BBC are exclusive to it.
No, like I said, it's the only institution that's owned by the British state, and therefore it should be held to a higher standard, which it's fallen short of.
But then what's the suggestion? If you get
abolition.
Abolition. Okay, well then what do you have? Then you just have
funding has been incrementally slashed over the past 12 years. The
state should not own a corporation which runs news, which, shows documentaries educating people.
What's the alternative, though? Like Fox News or some, like, where it goes off in, like, crazy left-wing and crazy right-wing directions? Like, it's going to be so partisan and will divide people even more.
There are regulations on channels that aren't the BBC, so ITV, Channel 4, which partially state-owned, all channels in this country, or all the big ones at least, or their news still has to follow the, has to at least pretend to follow or act as though it's following the balance policy, similar to the BBC. So you can put regulations on private as well as state-owned corporations.
But then when you allow private interests to come into to news, I think that opens the door to potentially those interests being reflected in the news that you're being presented with, like you have in America and definitely. France, for example.
Do you think ITV is that problem at the moment? Because they obviously are funded by private companies advertising.
I don't watch ITV a lot, if I'm honest, so I wouldn't be able to give a comprehensive review
Doctor
of
Who,
that,
doesn't
to be honest.
BBC's
better. Hey, Freya, that bloody ITV.
Occasionally, not that often.
Rubbish. Coronation.
State interests are titanically more, potentially titanically more destructive than corporate ones. Think about the number of people killed in the last just over a century by communist and fascist regimes. It massively outweighs the number killed by, you know, private individuals and corporations. Of course, they can do bad things, but only the state has the means to do those things on such a large level. And obviously, that's not happening in this country now. But if you have state-owned media, you lay the foundations for that to potentially happen in the future. We always say, oh, it won't happen here. Well, I thought the coronavirus lockdowns wouldn't happen here when I saw it in Italy. This country has changed, and the BBC is a potential danger, or is indeed a danger now, as has been displayed by their fear-mongering.
Well, that very interesting discussion. I think we'll leave this one here. But I personally like a show on the BBC called Doctor Who, and I haven't liked how it's been going in recent years. So in a way to link it to my next song, I want good Doctor Who back. I want it back for good.
Bring back Christopher Eccleston.
Okay, welcome back to the third part of the show, which is on rewilding the countryside. So, the government inherited the agricultural payments that originally the EU paid to farmers, and in the next 2 years it's planning on cutting that payment by half. Interestingly, the SNP Labour government and Northern Ireland Assembly, so that's Wales, Scotland and Northern Ireland, they are all keeping the payments, but the United Kingdom government, which is obviously controlled by the Conservatives, which are voted in by farmers, are cutting that by half in 2 years' time. They are planning on giving £650 a year per hectare to farmers to not do anything with their land and instead let it rewild back into its natural state if the farmers weren't there. What do we think of this? Who wants to go first on the countryside rewilding? Any pickers?
I come from a rural area. I come from Cornwall, and it's one of the places in the UK with the greatest inequality. And so I feel like we shouldn't be giving the people that have got more money even more money for doing nothing. Although I do support rewilding. I think that the money could be better spent elsewhere, lowering energy bills for people. I think that's probably more important than giving wealthy people even more money.
Well, are they wealthy? This is the question, because lots of farmers don't actually make any profits anymore with their crops and are basically being funded simply by the state to keep going. I mean, Jeremy Clarkson's programme, but Clarkson's Farm, he made lots of terrible mistakes on that programme, so I hear. I haven't actually watched it, but he made a profit of, what, 70-something p?
I think £118.
£118, okay, yeah. This is a state that many farmers are in, and particularly as they're being undercut by foreign crops from abroad, particularly this is now going to come with the new deals that the UK has made with Australia and New Zealand post-Brexit. Anyone else got any thoughts on
it's a catastrophic policy. It's hard to begin because there's so many reasons not to support it, but obviously the purpose of farming is growing food for people to eat. I think there's very few things you can think of that are more important than eating beyond drinking and breathing. Currently, we import 48% of our food into this country. This country's population is unsustainable in terms of the amount of food we can produce here. We need as much farming here as possible. Turning one of the most arable countries in the world into a nature reserve, a zoo full of wild animals, is insane considering the population density. We need all the farmland possible. Also, if we can't grow enough food here, and if we can grow even less food here, we'll be having to ship it in from abroad on planes if it needs to stay fresh, or on boats for those who are concerned about carbon emissions and all that sort of thing. Obviously that will make that go up. It will damage rural communities if people can't afford or don't have their livelihoods, if people who work on farms no longer have a job. And then of course there's the misconception that farming is and human beings in the countryside are in conflict with the natural environment. That's not true. It's the farmers, gamekeepers, they're the stewards of, you know, our oaks and pasture, our green and pleasant land. They're the ones protecting it. There was an example in Dartmoor, an animal rights group, bought a patch of land in Dartmoor, a few thousand acres or so, populated it with deer. Within a year, 100 of those deer had died of tuberculosis, and that tuberculosis had spread to surrounding populations, farm animals and other deer. The way that to keep a healthy environment is to manage those animals, hunting weak ones. That's obviously, fox hunting's now illegal. It's still legal, fortunately, to, you know, shoot pheasants and other creatures like that. But they want to take that away. There's this idea that nature reserves are good for the environment, but they're not. It's not real. It's still man-made. I think this is really an example of where city policing gets in the way of the countryside, and where we should perhaps leave each other alone.
One of the interesting points you make here, Cameron, is about making the country a nature reserve, but even nature reserves are maintained. This is not even part of the government's policy. They just want fields to be left. There are fields near where I live in the countryside, that have been left, and they are full of weeds. That's it, really. And squirrels, which I know are quite nice, but really they are glorified rats in some ways. They are pests.
Not even native,
gracefully. They're not even native to the country. It hasn't improved the habitats. Now, there are other things the government could do, like hedgerows and things like that. That does improve a lot of wildlife. But I do see your point here, Cameron, that this seems to be misguided, even in terms of saving the environment, because if we're getting more crops from abroad, that is increasing carbon emissions. I don't really see if rewilding is going to improve the local wildlife.
As far as I'm aware, the proposed rewilding locations aren't actually land that's being currently farmed on. It's just it wouldn't change the production level, is what I'm saying. Obviously, maybe that land could be farmed on, and I appreciate that, but there is things that we could do to make our farming more sustainable, like in terms of like crop rotation and keeping the soil full of the nutrients that over farming gets rid of. But I completely agree that we should be trying to keep as much of our food production in-house, because, you know, for all the reasons Cameron just said about reducing carbon emissions from transport and also beneficial to the British economy. It seems like a little bit of a limp attempt to try and sort of have a bit of a headline to say that you're doing something, but actually sort of lacks investment and lacks sort of consideration. That's how it kind of seems to me, but I don't know what you guys think.
And interesting what Sarah was saying about where the money's going is that all the people that are agricultural workers or tenant farmers, they don't get this money. And often tenant farmers are people that have maintained land for a landowner for generations. It's all they've ever known. They go to school and then they go to agricultural college, even though they already know a lot of stuff because they've been taught it by their parents, and then they go and farm on the land. And I think what we're seeing here is the 2020s version of what happened in the 1980s with mining, in the communities that have established around a certain way of life are being undermined. But what's interesting is that this is being done by the Conservatives, which farmers continuously always
betraying their own voters.
And are we see they're witnessing that perhaps this realignment of voting is happening? If Labour is saying actually we should continue funding farmers, and the Conservatives saying no we shouldn't, are we going to see perhaps the countryside turning to different political parties? Sarah isn't shaking her head, doesn't
she? No, unfortunately I don't think so. I think that farmers would have very few incentives to vote for Labour. As long as...
Because they hate our green and pleasant land.
because they like a bit
they
of...
They hate England!
They like redistribution, which is something that farmers don't really like. So I think that saying that the countryside will turn to red is just ridiculous.
A new party could come in and take the votes. A rural
you say
party.
Like the Liberal Democrats.
Well, we're one North Shropshire. didn't they? Which is a very rural seat.
I mean, Jeremy Corbyn's Labour certainly liked redistribution. I don't know whether the same applies to Keir Starmer's Labour. He seems to be sort of trying to take it to the sort of centre ground a little bit more. I'm not sure that'll be enough. To your point about farmers being sustained basically by government subsidy, I don't think farms that are unsuccessful should be being sustained for the sake of it. I think government subsidy is fine when it comes at, you know, conditions of, you know, sustainability, for example. But you certainly just shouldn't be propping up farms
it's not unsustainable. It's for the sake of having food on your plate.
Yeah, I understand that. But if you're just propping up a farm just for the sake of it, when actually that farm isn't economically successful, nor is it sustainable for the planet, you could do something different with that money to either change the management of that farm so that it is beneficial. Because at the moment, we've got a lot of farms that aren't sort of that good.
Farmers have an active interest in preserving our green spaces because they need a healthy environment in order to grow crops. For example, there are no bees, then, well, obviously, food's not going to be pollinated anywhere near as well. If there are no hedgerows, the topsoil, especially from where me and Felix are from, often topsoil gets blown away if there aren't hedgerows protecting the fields from wind, managing wildlife. So hunting, obviously get food from hunting, but that also keeps down levels of species that will eat crops, crows, pigeons, creatures like that, that don't have many natural predators in this country. We forget that humans are part of the ecosystem and are top of the food chain. If we stop doing our sort of role as stewards, then things won't suddenly become natural again. It will be terrible.
Yeah, and much of that land that they're planning to rewild anyway, the soil is so damaged that the rewilding won't happen. It will just be bare, like you were talking about earlier.
You can graze animals on it.
Yeah, but that's what I'm saying, is that just leaving it actually doesn't actually do a lot.
Because they're not, there's no training programs, because it's a different job to be a nature reserve conserver and to be a farmer. They are different jobs, similarities, of course, but a person that's only known farming, you know, their father was a farmer, their grandfather was a farmer, and now they've been told to do nothing. I think it's an interesting one in terms of purpose as well. And it, as Cameron, I think you mentioned, it seems to suggest that this divide of the city and the countryside. I mean, it's interesting to note that Boris Johnson, Keir Starmer, Ed Davey, they all represent seats in London. Mm-hmm. Richard Tice, leader of Reform UK, comes from wanted to enter the London Assembly. I believe the Green Party leaders also tried to enter the London Assembly. So there does seem to be a London-centric focus. This comes into this whole levelling up agenda, perhaps, as well. That it's not necessarily just finance. I think many rural areas do also require finance. It's very poor. I would say my village, I'm not going to name the village, but we have one bus that goes to the nearest city and it leaves once every Thursday and it doesn't come back. And there is very much a lack of funding in the countryside. I think that this, do you think this opens up the levelling up agenda that actually needs to go everywhere outside of London, not just in the north of England, which of course it does also require?
I think picking up on the levelling up thing is really, really important, because particularly I find in Cornwall the public transport is appalling, and so is the education's also pretty. It's not great. It's not great considering the geographical size of Cornwall, the few institutions that there are. It's quite embarrassing, really. So I think that we should be.
Is it bad schools or universities?
We haven't got any Russell Group universities in Cornwall.
Was it Falmouth you got?
Falmouth.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Where are you from?
North Cornwall.
Yeah. Inside. What's your like town?
Bodmin. So the money should be spent elsewhere, I think.
Yeah, there's this I mean, again, my village doesn't have a school, it doesn't have a primary school, and that also helps with the local community. If you've got everyone going to school, people know each other, even if it's just talking outside the park. And community is important. I think actually that's something that the left and certain parts of the right, not the libertarian, individualistic parts, but even some of them like community, individuals of being part of the community. I think that's something that all sides of the political spectrum are having an issue with at the moment, that I suppose with more modern technology and different ways of working and communicating with people, that local community is going, and which is very beneficial to some people. Yes, the levelling up agenda, which this also falls into the whole issue that there doesn't seem to be any levelling up occurring at the moment.
But it seems like it sounds like an empty signifier.
Yeah, it does,
necessarily the cloud. Like, it means lots of different things to lots of different people, but nothing actually seems to be.
It doesn't seem very concrete.
Concrete or levelled up.
Sounds like urbanisation to me. Yeah, it's clear that this just comes from the fact that the political establishments from London and other cities, they don't understand the countryside. Now, I don't really understand why no one would want to live in a city, and I wouldn't tell people how to live in a city, but people in the city, especially if they're going to stop funding and subsidising farmers to grow food, then they need to stay out of telling farmers what to do and let them grow food and feed the nation.
It's going to be an interesting one to see what happens, and I think there's a... With the shift of political spectrum and perhaps the Conservatives, people feeling in, who might have voted Conservative for the first time now thinking, actually, maybe the Conservatives aren't representing me, and even traditional Conservative voters also thinking that, I think it's going to be an interesting time in politics going forward. George, do you have anything to say on this in any particular...
No, not particularly, Felix.
Okay, all right. Well, I thank you, everyone, for coming on to The Big Picture. Thank you to George, to Cameron, to Sarah and to Freya for coming on. It's been a very interesting discussion. Obviously, lots has happened over the Christmas holidays. It was difficult to choose, and we had other honourable mentions. I was considering was Tony Blair's knighthood, the potential invasion of Ukraine, Prince Andrew's stripping of his titles. Lots have happened, but I hope this has been good. And as we've been talking about the green and pleasant land, we've got an interesting hymn to finish us off with. So thank you very much for listening. And see you next week, where Thomas Gregory will be back. Goodbye.
Is it?